Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. A new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name.
Let us pray. Father, we thank You and bless You for this opportunity that we have to be able to listen to Your word, and we pray that Your word will transform us. Your word will change our life and will draw us closer to You, make us better people. Thank You, O Lord, that in Jesus Christ we have found a friend that never disappoints. Thank You forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Power off.
Amen. I want to thank God for the opportunity that we have today. I want to thank God for the fact that you have visited our website and you are listening to this podcast. I pray that it will be a blessing to you. Feel free to come again and again to download our podcasts. I am your host, Pastor Dr. Kemi Atanda Ilori, the General Overseer of Living Hope Church. The title of today's podcast is Taste and See That the Lord is Good. Taste and See That the Lord is Good. Our key scripture is from the Psalms. Psalms 34 verse 8. Psalms 34 verse 8. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Blessed is the man, blessed is the woman, blessed is everyone who trusts in God. We are constantly invited and urged to come to God, to have a personal experience of His greatness and goodness. Nearly every religion and every culture has something to say about God, and why and how we should experience Him. Personally, I'm deeply, deeply grateful to God for bringing me into fellowship with Him through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That word fellowship simply means relationship, means communion. It means being obedient to God, following God. It means trusting in God. All of that through the Lord Jesus Christ. From Genesis to Revelation, all the books of the Holy Bible teach us that God created us and He desires that we should have a thoroughgoing relationship with Him. The kind of relationship that you find between parents and their children. However, our behavior always falls far short of the expectations of God. When our behavior falls far short of the expectation of God, the Bible describes that as sin. That's what we mean when we say we sin, that we are sinners. We are people whose expectation, whose conduct often falls far short of the expectations of God. The Bible teaches us that we can trace that far back to the time of Adam and Eve, our human parents, who failed to live up to the expectations of God in the Garden of Eden. We see the story in Genesis chapter 3. They sinned. Sin always creates a wedge between us and God. No matter how we try, sin always damages our relationship with God. In fact, it does more than damage. Sin destroys that relationship. Sin destroys that relationship. As a result of sin, we then have a very distorted view of God. We have a distorted view of ourselves. We have a distorted view of the whole of creation. Sin causes our heart to be in rebellion against God. Instead of seeking God, we seek our own ways, and we concentrate on pleasing ourselves rather than God. Such is the destructive nature of sin, the totally destructive nature of sin, that we can never, ever, on our own, seek to go back to God. Most religions attempt to draw us back to God. However, the Bible shows us practically that religion can never succeed in drawing us back to God. Only Jesus can. Only Jesus, the Son of God, can draw us back to God. In Genesis chapter 6, we find a story about how God was so displeased with the horrible and wicked things that were going on in the world at that time that he decided to destroy the world and start all over again. But before doing so, God chose Noah and his family to build a boat. And God directed everyone and everything that God wanted to save to enter Noah's boat. God then caused a universal flood to destroy the whole world. But those that were in Noah's boat were saved. Maybe there were other boats. Maybe there were other people who were trying to say, "Come into my boat, you will be saved from the flood." But as we see in that story, the only approved person was Noah. The only approved vehicle of salvation was Noah's boat. In the same way, God has chosen only one person and only one way to save people from eventual destruction. Sin damages. Sin destroys our relationship. God takes the initiative to bring us back, because we will never go back to God, left to our own devices. And the initiative that God took was Jesus, his only begotten Son. God sent him to die on the cross, to shed his blood. Jesus lived a sinless life. So a sinless person died on the cross for the sinful. Because his life was pleasing to God, God accepted his sacrifice. And anytime we place our faith, anyone who places their faith in Jesus, God accepts them. Because the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. When we place our faith in Jesus, we come to a place where we genuinely repent of our sins. And God creates a new heart for us. He gives us a new heart. And on top of that, God gives us his Holy Spirit so that through the wonderful, effective work of redemption, of salvation that Jesus did for every man, every woman, every child on the cross, our relationship with God can be restored. Jesus is the only one, and the way of Jesus is the only way by which we can be saved. Because if we are not saved, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death. It's not just physical death. Everybody will die. But eternal separation from God. And as we know in the Bible says when we are eternally separated from God, that means we go to hell. So to save us from hell, where sin is leading everyone, God took this wonderful initiative and gave us his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, so that when we place our faith in him, the work of salvation is done. John chapter 1, verse 10 to verse 12. Jesus was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Those were the Jewish people. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And Jesus himself says to us, he was teaching his disciples this wonderful truth in John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." We are not going to be saved by religion. We are not going to be saved by any other name. except the name of Jesus. There is no one who qualifies to be the Savior of the world except Jesus. In John chapter 11, verse 25 to 26, Jesus says this, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. There is no salvation in any other name. No salvation in any religion at all, except in the name of Jesus, except in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation is only found in the finished work that Jesus accomplished on the cross when he died on that cross, shed his blood. He met all the requirements of God. And when we go to God through Jesus, our sins are forgiven. We are given a new start because we are given a new heart. A heart that is obedient, a heart that is compliant, a heart that loves God. That is my own experience. And this is why I'm saying to each one of us as we are listening today, beloved one, taste and see that the Lord is good. And the only way you can do that is through Jesus Christ. I invite you to do that today. What are the things you will taste when you come to God through Christ Jesus? What are the things you will enjoy? What are the things that will be your permanent markers of experiencing God? Well, they are the attributes of God, who God is, what makes him God, everything about God. That's what you will enjoy. When we say, taste and see that the Lord is good, what it means is that you will enjoy God to the uttermost. The Bible reveals many attributes of God, many characteristics of our Heavenly Father. Some have listed them as 28, and they have said you can break them into two categories: the greatness of God and the goodness of God. Today on this podcast, I'm not going to be looking at 28 or even more attributes. I'm going to look at just five by the grace of God. These are the five that have opened all the doors that I need to enter through into enjoying God bottomlessly, endlessly. I share these five with you because they help me to enjoy the entirety of God, to enjoy God to the uttermost, to the fullest. Five attributes. The first one, God's omniscience. God's omniscience. God knows everything. God knows everything. And I will tell you some of the things that I've enjoyed in knowing that God knows everything, in my relationship with God through Christ Jesus, in my fellowship, in my worship, in my serving him, in my love for him, my love for other people. I want to show you so many aspects that I enjoy in the omniscience of God. Psalm 139 from verse 1. "You have searched me and known me, O Lord. You know my sitting down and my rising up." God is ever present with me. The ever gracious presence of God provides security. It provides safety. It provides comfort. It provides assurance. Tells me I'm not alone. God is with me. No matter where I am, no matter what is happening around me, God's omniscience, that God knows everything, focuses my heart, focuses my prayers, focuses my life on pleasing God, on enjoying him. You know my sitting down, you know my rising up. You understand my thought afar off, all my desires, all my plans. You comprehend my path and my lying down. You are acquainted with all my ways. There is not a word on my tongue. But behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You know me through and through. Gives me joy. It brings me into a place where I can relate to God in an in-depth way, in a passionate way. You have edged me behind and before and laid your hand upon me for good. I'm surrounded by God. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, O God, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. What a great comfort, great safety, great security that God knows everything. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. No matter where I am, no matter what is happening, the very fact that God knows everything tells me that He is about. The Lord is there. The safety, the security, the comfort, the understanding, the awareness that my whole life is before God. He sees it all. He knows it all. For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they all were written, the days fashioned for me, all my days, how long I would live, the day I was born, the day I will die. Everything is completely in the hands of God. He knows everything. I can trust Him. I can rest easy. This is what makes me to be free of worry. I don't worry at all. Never, by the grace of God, I don't worry at all. Your eyes saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they all were written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there were none of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God! How great is the sum of them! On this podcast today, the title is Taste and See That the Lord is Good, and you can only taste God through Christ Jesus. And there are five things that I'm bringing out to share with all of us, things that have helped me to enjoy the greatness and the goodness of God, instead of the 28 attributes and even more that some people have listed. I'm sharing just five with us. And the first one was God's omniscience. The first one is God's omniscience. The second one is God's omnipotence. God is the Almighty. Nothing is impossible with Him. Genesis 18 verse 14. God says, is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. God was talking to Abraham. God had promised Abraham and Sarah that they would have a child. But Abraham grew old, Sarah grew old, and as far as the biology is concerned, their biological clock in relation to having children has stopped. They can never have children again. But the omnipotence of God is working behind the scene, working in their life. And so their biological clock, even though it has stopped, with God all things are possible. So God says to Abraham, forget your biological clock. I'm the God who created you. I'm the God who can switch it on or switch it off. And I have made a promise. I will keep my promise. By this time next year, your wife Sarah shall have a son. In the book of Numbers, chapter 11, the people who are being taken out of the bondage of Egypt and have been taken through the wilderness to the promised land that God had in store for them. They started to complain. They said, we have no meat to eat. We want to eat meat. They complained to Moses. They complained against God. And God said to Moses, okay, I will provide meat for them for a whole month. So Moses in Numbers chapter 11 from verse 21 says, oh God, the people whom I am among are 600,000 men on foot, yet you have said I will give them meat that they may eat for a whole month. Shall flocks and herds be slaughtered for them to provide enough for them? Or shall all the fish of the sea be gathered together for them to provide enough for them? If you are just counting the men, there are 600,000. What about the children? What about the women? So we are talking about more than 1 million people, maybe 2 million people in the wilderness. That's why the faith of Moses, this incredible man of God, his faith was staggered. How will God provide meat for all these people in the wilderness? And this is what God says in verse 23, Numbers 11, verse 23. And the Lord said to Moses, as the Lord's arm been shortened, now you shall see whether what I say will happen to you or not. God is the Almighty God, and God fed all these people in the wilderness with meat. He provided it just as he had promised. Nothing is impossible with God. God is not waiting for you to help him, or for a government to help him, or for anyone to help him to achieve whatever he wants to achieve in your life. He commands and it is done. The omnipotency of God. God is omnipotent. Jeremiah 32 verse 17. Ha, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you. I enjoy this. I enjoy the almightiness of God. Nothing too hard for him. It actually helps my prayer life. It helps my plans and purposes. It helps me in my relationship with God. It helps me in my relationship with others. It tells me something so fundamental about God, something that I keep enjoying bottomlessly and endlessly. In Jeremiah chapter 32, from verse 26 to 27, then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? And I reply, nothing is too hard for you, O God. That's my reply. What will be your reply? Unless you come and taste that the Lord is good through Christ Jesus, you won't have the certainty of what I am talking to you about today. You won't experience it to the fullness. This is my own experience. I have tasted and I have seen that the Lord is good. The third attribute of God that has really, really helped me, that I've really enjoyed and I keep enjoying, God's omnibenevolence. God's omnibenevolence. We start with God's omniscience, then God's omnipotence, and now we are coming to God's omnibenevolence. God is supremely good. God is absolutely good. There is evil in the world. Calamities, disasters, dangers, destructions, all sorts of things that make the world a very challenging place. The Bible shows us that that has to be because sin is in the world. But God is good. In spite of all the things that you might think of, that you might say, why does a good God permit these things to happen? God is absolutely good. God is infinitely good. God is superbly good. God is supremely good. Nahum chapter 1 verse 7. The Lord is good, a strong day in the day of trouble, and he knows those who trust in him. I have tasted the goodness of God. I'm enjoying the goodness of God. Psalms 145 verse 8. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. That's part of the omnibenevolence of God, the supreme goodness of God. The Lord is just so good, so awesomely good. May you enjoy the goodness of God. I have to move on. We are today on this podcast saying, come and taste and see that the Lord is good. And you do that by coming to Jesus. And when you come to Jesus and you personally experience God, all the doors open into what God has to offer, the fullness of God. All the doors open for you that you will be able to enjoy the fullness of God, the attributes of God, what makes God God. I'm moving on because of time. God's providence, I enjoy that a lot. In Living Hope Church, we enjoy that a lot. What is God's providence? It simply means God's governance of the whole universe and human affairs. God is in absolute control of the whole universe and human affairs. Whether it rains or shines, you might think of volcanoes, hurricanes. You might think of so many things, earthquakes, droughts. Listen, even though sometimes it seems that all these things happen randomly, there is no randomness. God governs every aspect of creation. The Bible says there is no sparrow that falls down that God does not know about. So when we are talking about God's providence, we mean God's governance of the whole universe and human affairs, how God sustains the whole universe. More importantly, we are talking about how God intervenes extraordinarily in the life of people to ensure that his own plans and purposes are fulfilled. That's what we mean by God's providence. How God, in his mercy, in his wisdom, intervenes extraordinarily in the life of people to ensure that his plans and purposes are fulfilled. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 26, lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things, who brings out their host by number. He calls them all by name, by the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one is missing. God sustains the whole universe. All the laws by which people send shuttles to the heavens, go to Mars, to Jupiter, to the moon, it's because God sustains all these things. He sustains them by the greatness of his might. Isaiah 45 from verse 5. I am the Lord and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun to its setting that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, do all these things. We are talking about this fourth attribute of God, God's providence, God's ability to govern all things, to control all things. You know, it gives me peace. It makes me to have that certainty that because God is in control, I have no fear and no worries. You know, you only know these things when you have come and you have tasted the goodness of God. There is no doubt at all in your heart about where you are, where you are going, what God will do. You're just so incredibly certain of the providence of God, that He plans all things, that all things are ordained by Him, and that you can pray into the purposes of God for your life, and that nobody can thwart what God has determined to do for you. Everything will work together for your good. See, Jeremiah 1 verse 5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. The day of our conception, of our birth, of our death, everything is governed by God. That's why we must choose, because He says choose. We must choose. Our choices matter. We must choose to come to God. He is already inviting us. He's made everything possible for us to come to Him. Now, the choice is yours. The choice is mine. Psalm 75, verse 6 to 7. For exaltation comes neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south. But God is the judge. He puts down one and exalts another. So I know that, by the grace of God, my promotion is going to come from Him. Nobody can actually delay that promotion. Nobody can stop it, because the providence of God is working for me. When we choose, by the gracious goodness of God, to embrace God, to come and taste that the Lord is good through Christ Jesus, providence will work for us. We won't be people who worry about things. We will know that God, in His mercy, has made everything ready to accomplish His good pleasure in our life. And all we need to do is to walk one day at a time with God. Isaiah 64, verse 4. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you, who acts for the one who waits for Him. Let's move on very quickly. Today we are on this podcast encouraging one another. Come and taste and see that the Lord is good. And the key scripture is from verse 34, verse 8. And I'm sharing with you that the best way, the only way actually, to come and taste and see that the Lord is good is through Jesus Christ. And what happens when we come through Christ is that He opens all avenues to us to enjoy God, to enjoy who God is. And I'm looking at five attributes. I've talked about God's omniscience. God knows everything. I've talked about God's omnipotence. God is the Almighty God. I've talked about God's omnibenevolence. God is supremely good. I've talked about God's providence. God is in control of all things, all affairs of man. And the final one, God's faithfulness. God's faithfulness. I'll read Deuteronomy chapter 7 from verse 9 to 10. Therefore know that the Lord your God, He is God, the faithful God who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations. He's so faithful. He keeps His covenant. He keeps His mercy for 1,000 generations. With those who love Him. Come on, Kemi. This is just an important aspect. He keeps His covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love Him and keep His commandments. And He repays those who hate Him to their face to destroy them. He will not be slack with him who hates Him. He will repay him to his face. So I know that no matter how long it takes. When somebody is wicked or evil, God will repay them. Whatever a man sows, he will reap. I know that. I'm really grateful to God that He's a great God who is faithful. God is just so faithful. Faithful to His promises. Faithful to His word. That has given me the kind of confidence that is so incredible, so awesome. My confidence in God, by the grace of God, is so incredible. I'm grateful to God. Taste and see that the Lord is good. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. If we are faithless, He remains faithful. He cannot deny Himself. God is just so faithful. That's why we know in Romans 8, 28, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. Fantastic. Those who are the called according to His purpose. That's because of His faithfulness. No matter what happens to me in life, for as long as by His grace I'm walking day by day with God, the best will always happen to me. The best of God will always happen to me. Provision, protection, providence, everything. All the promises of God. Come and taste and see that the Lord is good. This is what gives me incredible joy. No matter the circumstances, no matter the ups and downs, no matter the various things that can challenge our faith, I say to you, God in His mercy has placed me on the rock. I'm so secure. I'm so safe. These five important attributes of God, they open other doors before me. I enjoy God endlessly, bottomlessly, by faith. God is faithful. This is the final one that we've been looking at. God is faithful. That's why all things work together for good. So those who love God, some people, they just quote it. They don't quote the final part. All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. I'm going to be finishing on this one about the faithfulness of God. Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. For I am the Lord, I do not change. God does not change. God is constant. These are the five important attributes of God that open other doors into the goodness and the greatness of God for me. They open other doors into the goodness and greatness of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Device paired.
God is just so good to us. I want to finish by listening to an important song. I found a friend in Jesus. And that is where we will finish today. I want us to listen to it. I want us to enjoy it. I have found a friend in Jesus. What an awesome thing to know that we have found a friend in Jesus. Hallelujah. God is just so good. So good. The Lord is good. Let us pray. Father, we thank You for Your goodness towards us. We can come and taste and see that the Lord is good. Please, Father, increasingly bless Your word in our life. Help us to draw closer to You through Jesus Christ. Thank You, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in Him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. Yeah. sorrow is my comfort, in trouble is my stay. He tells me every care on him I roll.
He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Hope to me, Jesus, Lord, come. Ojo-bo-bo for me. Oh, Lariwati, upon me, bed. Oh, Nathan, I do. Oh, the end. To the way, baby, who didn't know. Oh, do to know me, Lodeni, go, go, wahala. Oh, Nikki, you me, no, no, all my grievous taken and all my sorrows gone. In temptation is my strong and my guitar. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols gone. From my heart and now he keeps me by his path. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempt me sore, through the Lord I shall safely reach the goal.
He's the lily of the valley, the bright and the morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
He'll never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. From his manna is my hungry soul shall feel. Then sweeping off to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of the life shall ever go.
He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Oh, he of him is silent, let me be your body. Me wanting my feet for coffee remote. Oh, Jody, no, you make up. You're very good. You're female, I'm a rebel. Come meet him. Bamba, that day, you go to Bukure. Tia, Kure, you mash on the Delilah.
Hallelujah. We thank God for that. Jesus is the only friend that we have. The Lord bless you today. Keep on walking with Jesus. He will never, ever fail you. God bless you. Bye-bye now. Bye.